चीफ मार्शल अरूप राहा टुक द रेन्स ऑफ द इंडियन एयरफोर्स इन जनवरी 2014. इन द पास्ट 30 months, दिस हैज बीन एन इवेंटफुल टाइम फॉर हिम एंड आई एम श्योर अ लिटिल बिट स्ट्रेसफुल ऑल्सो. बट वॉट हैज बीन हिज की अचीवमेंट्स एंड हाउ डज ही लुक बैक ऑन द एयरफोर्स परफॉर्मेंस एज वेल एज वॉट डज ही थिंक ऑफ द फ्यूचर ऑफ द एयरफोर्स. सो वी आर प्रिविलेज टू हैव हिम फॉर द नेशनल ब्रॉडकास्टर दूरदर्शन. Air Chief Marshal, thank you very much for your time and agreeing to give us this interview. When you look back at these 30 months that you have been at the helm of affairs, how do you assess the performance of the Air Force and your own performance in this?
You see, Indian Air Force is the fourth largest air force in the world. It is recognized to be one of the finest professional air force. And we have proven ourselves not only in various conflicts that you have fought, but also in various international exercises that you do. So we hold our own, you know, across the world as a professional air force. So as always proud to be his chief of the air staff, to be at the pinnacle of this organization, I always felt humbled because this chair has been occupied by so many legendary chiefs in the past. They are visionaries, and their leadership, their effort has brought the Air Force to the position that it is in today in terms of the foundation that they had laid. So I can straight away say that Marshal of the Air Force, the icon of the Indian Air Force, Marshal Arjan Singh, and of course the first Indian Air Chief, Air Marshal Subrata Mukherjee, and Air Chief Marshal P.C. Lal, who led the Indian Air Force in the 71 operations, are the visionary leaders I can think of. So I think it's a very proud privilege for me to occupy such an appointment in the Indian Air Force. And I must thank the Air Force for having let me grow and having put me at the pinnacle. Right in the beginning when I took over the reins, I realized the biggest challenge for me is going to be how to sustain the achievements and the progress and the trajectory of his growth path in terms of transformation in the recent times and of course the entire almost 7 decades of independent India. Not only sustain but to make enhancements in his progress would be even a bigger challenge. So I had determined that certain key result areas on which I would work continuously. I knew the Air Force is a very privileged to have many professionals at all levels, especially the senior levels. So it really didn't matter who was leading the Air Force. They would obviously perform and do well. So I did not change any of the policies and the directives that existed, which are, you know, time tested. So I decided to only tweak and fine tune these policies so that we are more effective and we are more professional and we produce the results. In keeping with the times, changing times. The first key result area, I'm not going to give you the key result areas in terms of some priorities, yeah. It will be at random.
Sure.
The first thing I thought that we need to enhance the relevance of the Indian Air Force to the nation.
Okay.
Air Force has always been relevant, but I wanted to enhance it further.
Right.
In that, I felt that we should not only be recognized as professional Air Force, it should be recognized because of its professional capabilities, and we should be distinctive in that, exclusive in that, but we should be totally inclusive
right.
in the service to the nation.
Yeah.
So towards that, we become more proactive in reaching out to the needs of the people,
right.
needs of the nation, needs of the government.
Okay.
So we did not wait for any indication or any signaling for us to do any service to the nation, especially in the area of humanitarian assistance and disaster relief.
That has been a very key achievement, I think.
Yes. So what we did was that we are always proactive.
Yeah.
The very moment we came to know that some disaster has taken place, not only in India, anywhere in the world, as soon as the ticker would appear on the TV, we would set into motion the entire process.
Sure.
Best example I can give you is the Nepal, you know, devastating earthquake.
Sure.
We put our forces into action straight away. We are ready.
Right.
Right. And within 4 hours, we are there.
Correct. Which is, I think, quite a record.
It's a record. That's because of the proactiveness. Right. And our people are ready. Mm-hmm. And we took along the army. Yes. We took along the NDRF, right. Okay, as well as other forces. Mm-hmm. And we are there in almost 4 hours' time. And we operated there for almost over a month under the able guidance and assistance of the Nepalese forces. Sure. And we not only helped them in the restoration and relief operations, but we also helped other nations, other air forces who wanted to come in and provide relief and rescue operations to Nepal. They all depended on us.
Right, because you almost took over the the running of the...
In the sense that as far as air operations are concerned, and we did provide facilities to many of these air forces. Even today, we get thank you letters and accolades from all the operators who went into Nepal from this. Similarly, we've been very, very proactive, like in Yemen, along with the Indian Navy and, of course, Air India, we are there, and within 24 to 36 hours, we evacuated nearly 2,000 people from Djibouti.
Yeah.
And in fact, it was not only Indian diaspora. Mm. We recovered a lot of
Westerners
and nationals from other countries. Right. So everybody was very thankful. Mm. And because of our proactiveness in HADR operations within the country and abroad, everybody...
Srinagar comes to mind, sir.
Yes, Srinagar itself was...
Floods.
Yes, yes. So I thought that, Indian Air Force has the capability in terms of speed and reach. And we can make use of the third dimension to be there in the quickest possible time and provide the relief and succor. Mm. So not only in terms of HADR, but also aid to civil authorities. You will find that during elections, general elections and state elections, the Election Commission has always been seeking help. MHA has been seeking help from the Air Force so that we could position their paramilitary forces, the police and security forces, their election officials, and EVM, electronic voting machines, from one place to another so that they could deploy in time without wasting time. Sure. And in a time-bound fashion, they could conduct the operations, maintaining proper security.
This never gets highlighted, really.
This actually doesn't get highlighted. We have never talked about it. Yes. But you can ask the Election Commission and the MHA. Yes. You'll realize that the Air Force has contributed tremendously in peaceful and proper conduct of...
So that brings me to, the fact that your helicopter fleet and the transport fleet with the induction of, the new... inductions like C-17 and C-130, although they're not exactly transport, they're also strategic airlift and medium airlift aircraft. That has been going on very well. But if you come to the combat potential or the combat power of the Air Force, are you satisfied with it, or what's your sort of take on that?
I think, the government has been quite generous, and my predecessors have done very well in the induction of large number of transport aircraft, strategic airlift aircraft, like the C-17. 10 of them have been operationalized in the recent times. C-130, one squadron of six aircraft, a special ops aircraft, extremely capable and versatile aircraft. Large number of Mi-17 V-5 helicopters have been inducted. So this has given us the capacity and capability to not only have strategic reach and footprint, and also, of course, help in mobilization, and of course, take care of HADR operations, including air maintenance and air logistics of our paramilitary forces, or the army, as well as state authorities. But definitely, as you mentioned, that we have had the problem of obsolescence in the combat fleet, the fighter aircraft fleet. This obsolescence is a problem with every Air Force. Every Air Force. It is not only with Indian Air Force, because Air Forces the world over are very highly technology savvy, technology intensive.
Sure.
And the shelf life of any technology is only reducing.
Absolutely.
So therefore, even the best Air Forces in the world have this problem of obsolescence.
Sure.
Even the F-16s, which operate in maybe the US Air Force, are almost four decades old, unless it is the latest version.
Sure.
So there is a need to sort of replace them in time.
Right.
We have had problems in terms of timely replacement of our obsolete fleets.
Sure.
I would have been happy if the replacements came in much faster. We have an issue in terms of the acquisition process, which the Honorable RM is taking care of in terms of having new policies in terms of DPP, Defense Procurement Policy, which will make sure that induction process is quickened and it becomes much faster. But the government and the RM himself has taken a lot of interest in trying to acquire the Rafale, 36 of them off the shelf, and a government-to-government deal, which will, of course, will help us in building our capability. Mm-hmm. The LCA is getting a facelift. A lot of effort is being made to bolster its productivity in terms of production capacity of the HAL and the DRDO, that is the ADA, that is the aeronautical agency of the DRDO. Mm-hmm. So I'm very sure that this aircraft, the LCA, will also get operationalized by the end of this year. The first squadron will be operational. Right. And HAL has been asked to ramp up the production.
Right.
And it has also agreed, along with the DRDO, to improve the quality of the aircraft in terms of its capability, be it radar,
right,
missile combination, and air-to-air refueling capability, right, and electronic warfare suite. So we're going to get it soon, but we still...
I need to take a break, sir. I'll come back to you on both Rafale and LCA,
okay,
because we need to take a small commercial break. We'll come back to you in some moments. Thank you.
Now the National News Channel of India, live on your mobile phone. Get the news on the go. Watch top videos, get the latest news and continuous news on your mobile phone. Download DD News app now. Visit the Android Play Store, search for DD News, download the app to your phone. Get the power of information at your fingertips. DD News. Only news, complete news.
Welcome back. We are in conversation with Air Chief Marshal Arup Raha, the Chief of the Indian Air Force. Air Chief Marshal, we were speaking about the LCA and, of course, the Rafale. Can you give us what is the LCA's potential and what have you asked the HAL to do so that it becomes better than what it is?
See, LCA is the indigenous production of a fighter aircraft. Of course, we lost track of the first aircraft that India had built indigenously, fighter aircraft, the Maruth HF-24. It was a very good aircraft. But unfortunately, we did not follow up. And we would have been much better off today in terms of indigenous capability in production of fighter aircraft,
okay,
which is a very critical area of any nation's defense capability.
Yes.
So LCA, I think it's taken its time, all right. But any nation,
mm-hmm,
any new aircraft production program,
right,
takes time.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for a country where it is being started ab initio,
sure,
I think it will take much longer.
Yeah.
Even if you take, say, the FGFA program,
yeah,
of the, say, Russians or the Americans or any other country, it takes at least 2 decades.
Yeah.
So maybe you have taken 1 decade extra, but it's all right.
We also went through sanctions. And
yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So I think it is a great achievement and we need to build on it.
Correct.
LCA is a reasonably good aircraft.
True.
In its category, that is the light category of fighter aircraft, we have 3 basic categories,
right,
light fighter aircraft, medium and heavy.
Maybe.
I can say that heavy would be the Su-30 class,
right,
which we have in large numbers.
Yes.
Rafale would be in the medium weight category, which is very, very potent.
Mm-hmm.
And I think LCA would be in the lightweight category.
Sure.
And it will meet that spectrum of our requirement. To my mind,
sure,
it only requires a little bit of enhancements,
mm-hmm,
in terms of its air interception radar.
Okay.
The latest is that we should get an ISR radar,
right,
and a combination of beyond visual range missiles,
mm-hmm,
which are already there, and the integration is already in progress.
Right.
And in fact, we should also have EW, electronic warfare suite, which is absolutely essential in any combat situation.
That's excellent news, I think. Yeah.
And we'll, mm-hmm, also have the air-to-air refueling capability. So these have been proposed and agreed to,
right,
and I think very shortly they should have these upgrades,
sure,
incorporated in the LCA, and we'll have large number of LCA coming into the Indian Air Force. As of now, we are going to have 20 aircraft by maybe middle of 18, mm-hmm. and another 20 aircraft, slightly improved version, sure. called the FOC,
right.
Final operation clearance, and that will be the second squadron,
sure.
and the new design that they have proposed
right.
should come through in another 3 to 4 years' time, and the series production to start. So in another 10 years' time, we'll have over 120
LCAs
with the Indian Air Force.
Indigenous aircraft, nothing
yes,
like
yes.
it.
No. And in fact, it will also find a good market in the neighborhood.
Right, which is also a thing. I don't want you to put a timeline to the Rafale induction or deal, but how hopeful are you about the Rafale, 36 Rafale that have been in negotiations?
I'm almost certain that the deal would be signed between the two governments and, of course, the Dassault Aviation Company.
Right.
See, it is a decision taken at the highest level.
Sure.
Okay. The MOU, the Memorandum of Understanding, was signed at the highest level.
Absolutely.
So I'm sure both the governments will be keen to honor that MOU, and IGA, that Intergovernmental Agreement, has been finalized.
Yes.
The offset details in the contract has been finalized.
Right.
The CNC for price negotiations are on. I think it's already in the final stages.
Right.
And I'm sure, as you heard the Honorable RM mention about it, that very soon it will fructify.
Right.
I'm very hopeful that it will be signed sooner than later. And hopefully next 2 to 3 years' time, we'll have the first squadron of Rafale flying in the Indian airspace.
But on that note, there have been concerns expressed at various quarters and even by retired officers or strategic experts about the twin threats that India faces, China and Pakistan. Is the Air Force, for our viewers' benefit, is the Indian Air Force capable of taking on those twin threats together or otherwise?
Okay, I'll go about it slightly roundabout way.
Right.
India is a peace-loving country.
Sure.
We have always wanted peace and stability and tranquility in the region for its economic development, for the good of the people.
Yeah.
And we are interested that tranquility is maintained so that entire region becomes an economic region.
Sure.
The integration economically in the region is very important.
Absolutely.
So everybody grows.
Yes.
And we'll have to leave aside whatever issues and problems that we have, the friction that is there in the region. But unfortunately, we have been drawn into conflicts as a part of the historical baggage, be it the partition or otherwise. So despite our good intentions, which is well enshrined in various doctrines like the Panchshil, we have been NAM, one of the leaders in the NAM, non-aligned movements. We have always participated in the United Nations peacekeeping activities. So our intentions are very good.
Yeah,
but we have had to fight a number of conflicts because you're drawn into it for various reasons.
Absolutely.
So as of now, we have to cater for a conventional threat,
sure.
a sub-conventional threat, that is terrorist attacks, which India is one of the worst victims of terrorist attacks,
sure.
which has been sponsored by some of our adversaries, I would say. And we also have the nuclear overhang.
Sure.
That is the non-conventional threat. So India has to prepare itself to deter
right.
a conflict. The best way to deter a conflict is to have the capability.
Strong,
yeah. So we are going to look for the capability and build the capability. It is not against any particular country or nation.
Right.
It is a capability which will make sure there is no conflict in the region, because strength is very important.
Yes.
And to my mind, it is not specific to any country. Towards this, we have a lot of plans.
Right.
We have the long-term integrated perspective plan
sure.
for all the three services.
Mm-hmm.
So the Indian Defense Forces are capable to take on any challenge anytime. It is not specific to any country.
Yes, I understand that. But that brings me to the question of integration of all the three services and the question of the Chief of Defense Staff. Since you've been perhaps one of the longest serving Chairman Chiefs of Staff Committee, what is the view, not only your personal view, but of course, what is the government thinking about it? Do you think it's essential?
I think every idea has its time.
Right.
And CDS, the time is ripe for implementing the CDS scheme.
Sure.
I think so many committees and task force have been, and the studies have been carried out in the past,
right.
each and every committee, every task force, especially the Naresh Chandra Task Force,
yes.
NCTF, they all recommended that India needs SCDS, as a single point military advice to the government, following the patterns of so many other developed countries, you know, all over the world. They are following this system, and I think we can adopt replicate the good things about the CDS system. Sure. We need not copy it totally from any country, because our circumstances, our ethos, our threat perceptions, our requirements will not be same as the others. And therefore, we have to adapt it to our requirements. But the time for a CDS has come, and I think we all need to have it. And I think the government is working on it. And a lot of efforts are being taken to just finalize the thing.
Sure.
But if we have a CDS, there is a need for a proper structure.
Correct.
You must have a good organization to support the CDS. Mm-hmm. The integration of the headquarter IDS, mm-hmm. that means the wing that works under the CDS, the tri-service organization,
sure.
should be totally integrated with the Ministry of Defense.
Right.
Then only it will be productive, mm-hmm. then only it will be effective.
Yeah, of course, it is incumbent on all that, but that is true. But let's come back to some of your achievements, which we sort of stopped midway. If you can come back to that, what are the other areas you are satisfied with?
So, you know, as I mentioned right in the beginning, we had determined a number of key result areas, approximately about 10 of them.
Sure.
I mentioned to you about, you know, improving or enhancing the relevance of the Indian Air Force,
sure.
which to my mind, we have done a lot. And second is, of course, operations, operational capability, that is the bread and butter of any defense force, so especially for the Indian Air Force. So we concentrated on enhancing the operational capability of the operational crew,
right.
basically air crew.
Okay.
Okay. So towards that, we needed to fly more.
Okay.
And you'll be happy to know that last financial year, 15-16, we flew 40,000 hours more than the last 10 years average.
Really? Oh, that's massive jump in the flying hours.
And it is 20,000 hours more than the previous financial year, 14-15.
Really?
So I think we have done a lot towards enhancing our operational capability. This we achieved by increasing the rate of exploitation of the available aircraft, serviceable aircraft, that is one, including the fighter fleet,
right.
where we had to close down some of the squadrons because of obsolescence.
Sure.
We flew about 3,500 hours more.
Even on those.
Despite that, because it is, I think, good planning,
right.
focused approach,
mm-hmm.
and getting the best, you know, maximal output from whatever we have.
That's wonderful.
So that is one area I think we have done well. Of course, we have got more trainer aircraft,
right.
more transport aircraft, more helicopters.
Yes.
All these have added to our flying effort, and that's how we managed to fly 40,000 hours more than the average of the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we also, operationally, we have done very well in conducting two large Air Force level exercises.
Right.
Pan Air Force, entire Indian Air Force was involved, all the operational commands, especially. That was Exercise Iron Fist, which was held in March this year, and of course, Exercise Live Wire. Which is Air Force level exercise,
mm-hmm.
the largest ever Air Force exercise to my mind,
right.
was conducted last year.
And you also, of course, went to Red Flag, which is another prestigious.
We did emphasize on showcasing our professional abilities,
mm-hmm.
and hold our own in the international community of Air Forces. And this year, we've been to Red Flag in Alaska after almost 7 years break.
Right.
And we chose Alaska over Nevada because we've been there, Nevada, before.
Oh, yes.
Alaska gives us a different opportunity, the
right.
environment,
yes.
the weather, climatic conditions.
Sure.
So, and I think we have gained a lot having exercised in Alaska. And on the way back, for Su-30s, stayed back in UAE.
Mm-hmm.
We did an exercise, you know, with the UAE Air Force.
Yes.
And it has been very, very fruitful.
Mm-hmm.
And we learned a lot, and I'm sure our partners also learned a lot from
sure.
our professionalism and approach. And we have done, actually, for the first time in the history of Russia and Indian
mm-hmm.
Defense Forces cooperation,
yeah.
we held bilateral Air Force level exercise
yes.
with the Russian Air Force last year.
Yes.
We went across, we flew their fighter aircraft, transport aircraft, and operated on the air defense systems.
Right.
Similarly, they came to India and operated similar, you know, aircraft and systems. So for the first time, it's a record that, you know, Russian Air Forces and Indian Air Force did work together. And we are going to make it regular.
That's an excellent news, because you've done the US and the Russians both.
Yes.
So on that note, I'm afraid, Chief Marshal, we have run out of the time completely. But thank you very much for your time and all the candid answers that you gave us. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.